Hello my dear students, in previous video we learn about respiration. In this video we are going to learn about transportation. Transportation is another important life process which helps living beings to survive. We learn in previous sections that blood transports food, oxygen and waste materials in our bodies. See, all living organisms need a few necessary components like air, water and food for their survival. All these substances are picked up at one part of the body and then transported to all other parts of an organism. And for all these required elements, there should be a transportation system. In plants, vascular tissue is responsible for transporting the substances. We learn in 9 that is xylem and phloem are the vascular bundles, vascular tissues which help for the transportation of water and photosynthetic products. Transportation in humans is done by the circulatory system. A complete system of organs is involved for this process. It is responsible for supply of oxygen, nutrients and removal of carbon dioxide. Students, in 9th, we learn about blood. Blood is a liquid connective tissue. It consists of fluid matrix called plasma and 3 types of cells suspended in plasma. Those are red blood corpuscles or red blood cells and white blood cells, blood platelets. Blood plasma. Plasma is pale colored liquid which is mostly composed of water. See, plasma contains about 92% of water and many proteins. Plasma transports food, carbon dioxide and nitrogenous waste in dissolved form. Blood cells. There are 2 types of blood cells, red blood cells and white blood cells. See, red blood cells contain hemoglobin in it. We learned in previous video that hemoglobin is a respiratory pigment of our body. This red blood cells contain hemoglobin and that hemoglobin gives red color to the blood. As hemoglobin is respiratory pigment, it carries oxygen from the lungs to tissues. White blood cells maintain self-defense mechanism of the body by releasing antibodies. The antibodies fight against disease-causing organisms and protect the body from various infections. So, WBCs or white blood cells, white blood corpuscles are also called as soldier cells of our body, because it creates the antibodies to fight against disease-causing microorganisms. Next one is blood platelets. Blood platelets help in coagulation of blood, that is clotting of blood. The blood transports nutrients, respiratory gases and waste products, hormones, enzymes and salts through circulation. And so, circulatory system is important part of our body for the survival. See, the circulatory system in humans mainly consists of heart, blood vessels and blood. Our pump, the heart. So this is the most important organ of our circulatory system. Heart is a muscular organ which is composed of cardiac muscles. See, human heart is a muscular organ located in rib cage between 2 lungs. It is so small that it can fit inside the adult's wrist. So the size of heart is as big as our fist. The heart is enclosed in tough and inflexible double lined membrane called pericardium. So the heart is situated in a double lined membrane which is inflexible, and that is called as pericardium. The space between heart and pericardium is filled with pericardial fluid, which provides frictionless movement to the heart and protects it from mechanical shocks. So, between the heart and pericardium, the membrane, fluid is present. That fluid is called as pericardial fluid. This fluid avoids wear and tear of the heart muscles. It gives frictionless movement because heart is made up of cardiac muscles which are continuously contracting and relaxing. So, it gives frictionless movement to the heart and also protect our heart from the mechanical shock. It is our pumping organ because this, with the help of heart, we can supply oxygenated blood to each and every part of our body. The human heart is composed of four chambers. That is, it is having four chambers. Two upper chambers are called as auricles or atrium. Auricles are thin walled, and two lower chambers called ventricles, and these ventricles are thick walled. So we are having right atrium, right ventricle, left ventricle and left atrium. Systole means what? Contraction of cardiac muscle is called systole, and diastole means relaxation of cardiac muscle. So heart is made up of cardiac muscles, and these muscles are continuously contracting and relaxing. So contraction is called as systole and relaxation of cardiac muscle is called diastole. This is the diagram of heart. We can see here four chambered heart. This one is 1, 2, 3 and 4. This upper two chambers are called as right atrium and left atrium, and these lower two chambers are called as right ventricle and left ventricle. See, the right and left parts are separated by septum to prevent mixing of oxygenated and deoxygenated blood. Here we can see the septum or the muscle septum, a curtain like structure between the chambers of heart. That septum is there for to avoid, to prevent mixing of oxygenated and deoxygenated blood. See, birds and mammals constantly use energy to maintain their body temperature, and so their energy needs are high, which are fulfilled efficiently because of non-mixing of oxygenated and deoxygenated blood. As we have to maintain our body temperature, we have to maintain it. It is not changing according to surrounding conditions. So, to maintain this body temperature, our energy requirement is more. And so, our body avoid mixing of deoxygenated and oxygenated blood, because to generate more energy, this mixing should be avoided. And for this, we are having this four chambered heart, and the chambers are separated by the septum. But in other organisms like reptiles and amphibians, the heart is of three chambered, as their body temperature changes according to the environmental conditions. According to the environment, their temperature changes. Their energy needs are comparatively low. Therefore, they can bear the mixing of blood to some extent. Fish have two chambered heart because blood is pumped to gills, where it gets oxygenated and then passes to the body organs directly. So here we can say that mammals and eels are having four chambered heart because their energy requirement is more, and so to avoid mixing of deoxygenated and oxygenated blood, their heart is four chambered. Then amphibians and reptiles are having three chambered heart because energy requirement is less as compared to mammals and eels, and so they can bear the mixing of blood. Fish have two chambered heart because blood is pushed to the gills, there it gets oxygenated and directly passed to the body or parts. In one cycle of pumping, blood enters the heart only once in the fish. Whereas in other vertebrates, the blood enters the heart twice in one cycle, and this is known as double circulation. When we will understand working of heart, you will come to know about the double circulation. It will be very much clear to you when we will discuss working of heart. Now see, this is the diagram of heart. You understand about the chambers, that is right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, left ventricle. Now we'll see working with the help of this diagram only. See the working of heart. As you know that our heart is made up of cardiac muscles. The rhythmic contraction and relaxation of these muscles result in heartbeat. Normally the rate of heartbeat is 72 times per minute. When the muscles of right atrium are relaxed, the deoxygenated blood is poured into right atrium by large veins, that is superior vena cava and inferior vena cava. We can see with the help of this diagram. See, whenever the right atrium relaxed, at that time the deoxygenated blood from all the body parts is poured into the right atrium. The right atrium contracts and right ventricle expands. The blood enters from right atrium to right ventricle through tricuspid valve. See, tri means three and cuspid means flaps. So this is the tricuspid valve which is having three flaps in it. Once the right atrium contracts and right ventricle relaxes. So as it relaxes, it expands and blood from right atrium enters into the right ventricle through this tricuspid valve. This tricuspid valve is there which prevents the backflow of blood at the time of contraction of ventricle. So these muscles are continuously contracting and relaxing. So when the right ventricle contracts, it will avoid the backward flow of the blood into the right atrium. Then the right ventricle pumps this deoxygenated blood to the lungs through pulmonary artery. See, this artery is called as pulmonary artery. When right ventricle will contract, the deoxygenated blood with the help of this pulmonary artery will go to the lungs. It will go to the lungs. And we know in the lungs, the oxygen get diffused into the blood and blood become rich with the oxygen. See, this pulmonary artery is the only artery which carries deoxygenated blood from heart to the lungs. Rest all arteries carries oxygenated blood from heart to all body parts. Now, in the lungs, blood get oxygenated. This oxygenated blood is carried by pulmonary vein and which pours that blood into the left atrium. See, this is pulmonary vein. This pulmonary vein is also an exception that rest all the veins in our body transports deoxygenated blood and the pulmonary vein transport oxygenated blood from lungs to the heart. So this pulmonary vein pours blood into the left atrium. It will pour the blood into this left atrium, oxygenated blood into the left atrium when it expands. When left atrium contracts, the oxygenated blood enters the left ventricle through a bicuspid valve. See, here there is a bicuspid valve is present. Bi means two and cuspid means flap. So here again one more valve is there, which is bicuspid valve, which avoids the backward flow of blood into the left atrium. So when the left atrium will contract, blood will enter into the left ventricle. The left ventricle is the largest chamber and main pump station. So this one is the largest chamber and main. So this one is the largest chamber and main pump station. When it contracts, the blood is pumped into aorta, the largest artery, and distributed to all the body parts. So this one is the aorta. So oxygenated blood, when left ventricle contracts, the blood enters into the aorta, which is the largest artery, and then oxygenated blood is distributed to all body parts. The blood is collected from different parts of body by small veins, which open into large veins, and these veins brings the blood back to the right atrium. This is how the cycle goes on. Students, you must have understood that how blood enters twice into the heart in one cardiac cycle. And so this is called as double circulation. See here, I can explain working of heart again with the help of this double circulation diagram. We can see here, see, these are the four chambers of our heart. Superior and inferior vena cava pour deoxygenated blood in right atrium. From right atrium, when the right atrium contracts, that blood enters into the right ventricle. From right ventricle, the deoxygenated blood goes to the lungs with the help of pulmonary artery. This is the only artery which carries deoxygenated blood from heart to the lungs. Then in lungs, the diffusion of oxygen takes place in the blood, removal of carbon dioxide takes place, and blood becomes oxygenated. Then from lungs, this oxygenated blood with the help of pulmonary vein enters into the left atrium. So pulmonary vein pour oxygenated blood into the left atrium. When left atrium contracts, blood enters into the left ventricle, and from left ventricle it goes to the aorta, which is the largest artery. This aorta divides into many arteries, and the arteries carry oxygenated blood. It transport oxygenated blood to all of the body parts. So this is working of human heart. We can see here also, this is also the representation of transport and exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide in our body. Double circulation. In the human heart, blood passes through the heart twice in one cardiac cycle. This type of circulation is called as double circulation. One cardiac cycle means one complete heartbeat in which all the chambers of heart contracts and relax once is called cardiac cycle. Just now we discussed that in fish, blood enters in heart only once, but in other vertebrates, blood enters in heart twice, and so it is called as double circulation. See, the rate of heartbeat is 72 times per minute. In one cardiac cycle, heart pumps about 70 milliliter blood, and thus about 4900 ml blood in a minute is pumped by our heart. Double circulation ensures complete segregation of oxygenated and deoxygenated blood, which is necessary for optimum energy production in warm blood animals. So in birds and mammals, energy requirement is more, and so this double circulation helps or ensures the segregation of oxygenated and deoxygenated blood. It prevents mixing of oxygenated and deoxygenated bloods and helps for optimum energy production. Next is the tubes, blood vessels, another component of our circulatory system. Students, you know how the pipelines are spread in house to transport water in different rooms, such as in washroom, in kitchen, in garden, etc. Also, we can see network of electrical cables to transport electricity to each and every point. In our body also, blood is transported from heart to various body organs and then back to the heart. This transportation takes place by three different sized vessels or the tubes. दोज आर आर्टरीज, वेन्स एंड कैपिलरीज. आर्टरीज आर थिक वॉल्ड वेसल्स विच ट्रांसपोर्ट ब्लड फ्रॉम हार्ट टू ऑल बॉडी पार्ट्स. हार्ट पम्प्स ब्लड इन टू आर्टरीज विद ग्रेट प्रेशर एंड सो आर्टरीज हैव थिक एंड इलेस्टिक वॉल टू टॉलरेट द प्रेशर एंड डू नॉट रपच्चर. आर्टरीज कैरीज ऑक्सीजनेटेड ब्लड एक्सेप्ट पल्मोनरी आर्टरी. वी डिस्कस दिस. पल्मोनरी आर्टरी इज द ओनली आर्टरी विच कैरीज डी ऑक्सीजनेटेड ब्लड फ्रॉम राइट एट्रियम टू लंग्स. ऑन रीचिंग एन ऑर्गन और टिश्यू द आर्टरी डिवाइड्स इंटू स्मॉलर एंड स्मॉलर वेसल्स टू ब्रिंग ब्लड इन कॉन्टैक्ट विथ ऑल इंडिविजुअल सेल्स. द स्मॉलेस्ट वेसल हैव वन सेल थिक वॉल्स आर कॉल्ड कैपिलरीज. सो हियर वी कैन सी द डायग्राम ऑफ आर्टरीज एंड वेन्स. सो दीज आर दिस इज द डायग्राम ऑफ आर्टरी विच कैरीज ब्लड फ्रॉम हार्ट. When arteries reach to the organ or tissues, it divides into smaller and smaller vessels, and those smaller vessels are called as capillaries. These capillaries are so thin, that is, the thickness is only one cell thick, and these capillaries provide blood to each and every part of the body. It provide blood to each and every cell. Their walls are permeable. And so that exchange of food material, gases and excretory substances takes place. So the capillaries then join together to form veins. Veins are thin walled vessels which transport blood from various body parts to the heart. So this is the artery which carries blood from heart to the or to all the parts of our body. And then artery get divided into smaller vessels called as capillaries. These capillaries again rejoin to form veins, and veins transport deoxygenated blood from various body parts to the heart. Veins do not have to withstand pressure, and so these are thin walled. But they are having valves to prevent backflow of blood. As blood is not flowing under pressure, so to avoid the backward flow of blood, veins are having valves in it. Veins carry deoxygenated blood except pulmonary vein, which carries oxygenated blood from lungs to the left atrium. Next is lymph. Before that, we'll discuss about maintenance by platelets. We have discussed composition of blood, that our blood contains plasma, blood cells. In the blood cells, we have discussed about red blood cells, white blood cells, and the platelets. These platelets are responsible for coagulation of blood or clotting of blood. Whenever we are injured or have a small cut anywhere on the skin, what do you see? We can observe within some seconds the bleeding stops, as there forms a plug which does not allow bleeding anymore. Think what would happen if the bleeding does not stop. The blood will drain out of the body and one can even die. So to avoid this situation, we have platelets in our body. These platelets circulate around the blood and forms blood clot wherever there is a leakage in vessels due to injury. Also, leakage would lead to loss of pressure, which would reduce the efficiency of pumping system. So, blood pressure is important to transport blood to all the parts. If leakage takes place in the blood vessels, then the pumping system will get affected, or efficiency of that pumping system get affected. Blood cannot reach to each and every part. And so to avoid such leakage, to avoid bleeding, platelets are there in our body. Next is lymph. Lymph, a yellowish fluid, escapes from the blood capillaries into the intercellular space. Intercellular means what? The space present between the two cells.
contains less proteins than the blood. So this lymph is another circulatory fluid in our body. It is also called as tissue fluid or extracellular fluid. So the fluid which is present between two cells or between the intercellular space is called as lymph or tissue fluid. Through the pores of walls of capillaries, some amount of plasma, proteins and blood cells, except red blood cells, escape into intercellular space in the tissues to form tissue fluid or lymph. It is similar to plasma but light yellow in color and contains less proteins. Lymph drains into lymphatic capillaries from the intercellular space. So from that intercellular space, that light yellow color fluid or lymph enters into the lymphatic capillaries. Lymphatic capillaries join to form lymphatic vessels that finally open into the veins. Lymph carries digested and absorbed fats from intestine and drains excess fluid from extracellular space back into the blood. So lymph flows from the tissues to the heart, assisting in transportation and destroying the germs. It contains lymphocytes which fight against infection. So lymph contains the lymphocytes which fights the which fights against infections or infection causing organisms. Lymph flows only in one direction, that is from tissue to heart. So here you can read, lymph flows from tissues to the heart, assisting in transportation and destroying the germs. So this is the circulatory system in human beings. Here we can see that the pumping organ is heart, arteries, blood vessels, arteries and veins, blood vessels, platelets and lymph. Here we can see the deoxygenated from the body poured into the right atrium when it is relaxed with the help of superior and inferior vena cava. From right atrium, when right atrium contracts, that blood, deoxygenated blood, goes into the right ventricle when the right ventricle expands or it is relaxed. When right ventricle contracts, blood goes to the lungs. Here, diffusion of oxygen takes place in the blood and blood becomes oxygenated blood. That oxygenated blood, with the help of pulmonary vein, enters into the left atrium. From left atrium, it goes to the left ventricle. From left ventricle, it is poured into the aorta, which is the largest artery. That aorta divides and into the arteries, which carries oxygenated blood to all the body parts, and again from body parts, deoxygenated blood is transported. This is the circulation of blood or the circulatory system in human beings. I hope you understood the circulatory system in human beings. Now we will discuss about transportation in plants. Like animals, plants also require water and nutrients to survive. The roots of plants absorb water and minerals from soil. Higher plants have specialized system for transportation. Soil is the main provider of water and minerals for plants. Energy requirement of plants are low as they do not move and have large number of dead cells in them. And so, slow transport system can fulfill the energy need of plant. So, the transport system of plant is slow as compared to animals as their energy requirement is less. And most of the plant cells are dead. So, the energy requirement is less as compared to animals. Plants have specialized vascular tissues for transportation of substances. These are two types of, there are two types of vascular tissues, xylem and phloem. Xylem is responsible for transportation of water and minerals. Xylem carries water, dissolved minerals from root to leaves through tracheids and vessels. See, these tracheids and xylem vessels are the conducting components of xylem tissue. So these are the conducting elements which conducts the water and minerals from roots to the leaves. Both are non-living with thick walls. So this xylem vessel and xylem tracheids are non-living dead component of xylem tissue. The xylem makes a continuous tube in plants which runs from roots to stem and right up to the veins of leaves. The distance through which water travels is small in small plants and large in large plants. Phloem transports food from the leaves to all parts of the plant with the help of its element sieve tubes. So sieve tubes are the conducting elements in phloem. Phloem is responsible for transportation of food. Phloem is composed of sieve tubes, companion cells, phloem parenchyma and phloem fibers. Out of that, sieve tubes are the main conducting element. It carries photosynthetic products or it carries food to all parts of the plant. See, this is the diagram of xylem and phloem. We can observe here in the xylem, there is only one way transportation takes place, that is transportation of water and minerals in upward direction only. And this xylem vessel are having thick walls stiff with lignin. Another diagram is of phloem vessels. We can see two-way flow of photosynthetic product, essential substances, water and food. And cells have end walls with perforations. This we discuss in 9th class also. Now we'll discuss about xylem tissues. In xylem tissues, vessels and tracheids are the main conducting components. Tracheids of vessels and tracheids of roots, stems and leaves are interconnected and forms a continuous system of water conducting channels reaching all parts of the plant. So it forms a continuous system, continuous channel for the transport of water. The absorption of water and dissolved minerals takes place by roots through root hairs. These root hairs are extension of epidermal cell. These are very small hair-like structure called as root hairs. These root hairs are the epidermal cells. These are in direct contact with the soil and takes up iron from the soil. Root hairs absorb water from soil by osmosis and take in minerals by the process of diffusion. We know about osmosis and diffusion. Osmosis is what movement of water from high concentration to low concentration through semi-permeable membrane. Whereas diffusion is movement of substances from high concentration to low concentration. So plants use osmosis and diffusion process for the transportation of substances. Difference in concentration of ions is created between root and soil, which enables water to enter into the roots. For example, these root hairs are in direct contact with the soil and the concentration of water is more in the soil and less in the root hair. Then, due to osmosis, water will move from soil to the roots. Same thing for the minerals. If the dissolved minerals are more in soil and less in root hairs or roots, then the minerals will move from high concentration to low concentration by the process of diffusion. See, ascent of sap, the upward movement of water and minerals from roots to different plant parts is called as ascent of sap. Loss of water vapor through stomata and lenticles in plants is called transpiration. So transpiration through stomata creates vacuum which create a suction called transpiration
pool. See, when tall plants, if the plants are tall, then the distance is more, and so for the transport of water, transpiration pool is created. What is transpiration pool? The water in the form of water vapor, loss of water takes place through the stomata, and so it creates the vacuum, which creates the suction effect, and that suction is called as transpiration pool. The transpiration pool sucks the water column from the xylem tubes, and thus water is able to rise to greater heights in the tallest plant. So in tallest plant, transportation of water takes place with the help of transpiration, by creating transpiration pool. And so the transpiration pools, with the help of transpiration, with the help of osmosis and diffusion, water and minerals reach to the leaves. Leaves utilize this water and minerals to prepare food. See the function of transpiration. It helps in absorption and upward movement of water and minerals by creating transpiration pool. Also, it helps in temperature regulation. Now we'll discuss how photosynthetic products move from leaves. Transport of food in plants happens because of utilization of energy. This transport of soluble products of photosynthesis is called translocation in phloem. So, flow of substances through phloem takes place in both the directions. It is a two-way traffic in phloem. Transport of food from leaves to different parts of plant is called as translocation. So, for transport of water, transpiration is there, and for transport of photosynthetic product, food, translocation is there. So, in plants, phloem helps for the transportation of food. Not only food, with that, phloem transports amino acids and other substances. These substances are transported to the storage organs of roots, fruits, seeds, and growing organs. So, wherever the food is required, there it is transported, and specially to the storage organs such as fruits, seeds, and growing organs. Every part of plant requires energy for building, for growth, and for maintenance. And so, translocation is very important, vital activity for plants. Translocation is what? The transport of food from leaves to all the parts of plant. And this translocation is important activity because each and every part of plant requires the energy. In translocation, the material enters the phloem tissue using energy from ATP molecule. This increases the osmotic pressure of tissue, causing water to move into it, and soluble material is then transferred from phloem. See, as the material enters into the phloem, the osmotic pressure increases, and due to that, water moves into it, and the soluble products, photosynthetic product, get dissolved into it, and then it transport from phloem to other tissues, which have less pressure than the phloem. According to requirement of plant, material is translocated from high osmotic pressure to low osmotic pressure. So this is all about the important life process, transportation. I hope you understood transportation in human beings and transportation in plants. Thank you. Have a nice day.